Hello, I'm Kristen Bandy with Arkansas Children's, and today on the Better Today, Healthier Tomorrow podcast, we're joined by Dr. Elaine Odiase. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Dr. Odiase is a pediatric therapeutic endoscopist, and today we're going to be talking about endoscopies. First question is, did I pronounce that right?
You did. Excellent.
Okay, perfect. Endoscopy. Yes. So that was one of my questions. How do you pronounce it? Because it's a hard one.
It's a mouthful.
It's a mouthful. So before we got started, I just wanted to make sure that we all knew how to pronounce it. So thank you for joining us today again. And let's start by telling me what it is you do here.
Oh.
What is your day like at Arkansas Children's?
Well, every day is different. One day I might be in clinic. Another day I might be in the OR in our endoscopy suite, seeing patients. Every day is different depending on the needs of the patients and the procedures that are scheduled, the emergencies that come into the ER or referred from other hospitals. Every day is different.
So, but what does an endoscopist do? When you say endoscopy, you called it a theater or suite?
So in our endoscopy room, we have endoscopy, obviously. So a lot of people will ask, what exactly is endoscopy? So endoscopy uses an instrument that we call our scopes. We have different scopes of different lengths, different scopes that have different channels for different instruments. So depending on what the patient needs, we might have a certain scope that allows us to look on the inside of the GI tract. And at the end of our scope, we have a camera and a bright light. And we are able to control and steer this instrument to better visualize directly the GI tract.
So what exactly is an endoscopy looking for typically?
So let me give you an example. We might have a patient that has seen their pediatrician with lots of abdominal pain, and they've tried different medications. They've tried different therapies, physical therapy, just trying to relieve the abdominal pain that they have. But they've had ultrasounds, x-rays, but still there's no solution. There's still no diagnosis. And oftentimes when they get referred to a pediatric gastroenterologist, we'll plan an endoscopy to allow us to look on the inside directly. And sometimes that can reveal the diagnosis, the problem. Not only are we able to look directly at the mucosa, but we're able to take pinch biopsies, really, really tiny, tiny biopsies. But under the microscope, we're able to see billions and billions of cells in order to find a diagnosis. And oftentimes that reveals what's going on, and we're able to treat and make the patient better.
So it's a very, very deep look into what's going on.
Exactly.
And figuring that out. You said millions or billions?
Billions and billions of cells.
Can't even fathom that amount of cells, but it just really kind of helps you pin down what's going on.
Yeah,
that's awesome. What sort of issues would bring a child in for, you mentioned abdominal pain, but what would typically bring a parent in with a kid that would require getting an endoscopy?
Well, there's an array of things. We talked about abdominal pain. Some kids will have vomiting that there's no explanation or haven't found an explanation of why they're vomiting. Some kids will have esophageal spasms where, of course, they don't necessarily know it's esophageal spasms, but they might have food getting stuck and having these panic episodes because they feel like they can't breathe. Or some kids having blood in their stool where they're stooling out blood. And that can be very, very scary for a patient and their parents. So those are some of the common things that make us want to go ahead and schedule an endoscopy.
Right. And the thing I struggle with as a parent, you say vomiting and tummy trouble, and these things are so common with kids. So figuring out the line between this is a normal kid thing and then, oh no, we need to go to a doctor, right?
Yeah.
So how would you find that line with something common? Like, I mean, obviously throwing up if they're doing it over a certain amount of time, but like complaining of tummy trouble. I had a kid that complained because they didn't want to go to school. My tummy hurts because they didn't want to go to school.
Yeah.
So how do you distinguish that other than just a pediatric visit and get it checked out?
And I think a lot of times we partner with the parents, and it's very helpful because that information is very helpful. We'll ask the mom or the dad, does the pain happen in the summer? Does it happen on the weekend?
Yeah, there it is. That's the hot tip right there.
Does it happen when they want to eat their the types of food that they want to eat, or does it only happen when we're having broccoli? You know?
That's clever. Huh? Yeah.
And then it also helps. Oftentimes, we partner so well with the local community physicians, the PCPs, the pediatrician, the family doctors, and oftentimes a lot of those issues get resolved when they see their primary care doctor. But a primary care doctor is gifted and skilled in knowing, hey, this is something else. This is a little bit more, and you need to be referred to a pediatric gastroenterologist. So we work so well with our PCPs in the community, and we wouldn't be able to take care of kids as we do without partnering with them.
Are endoscopies just for diagnosing, or are they ever part of the treatment as well?
That is an excellent question. That's when we differentiate between a therapeutic endoscopy and a diagnostic endoscopy. So oftentimes, one of the common endoscopies that we do is an EGD. So it looks at the esophagus, the stomach, so the gastrum, and also the small intestine. It's called the duodenum, and the EGD, so an upper scope. And that allows us to visualize the GI tract and then make a diagnosis. If we see a stomach ulcer, we're able to say, oh, here's the source of your pain that you've been having. Or sometimes we don't see it necessarily visually, but we're able to take biopsies and then look under the microscope with the help of our pediatric pathologists, and we're able to make a diagnosis. So that would be a diagnostic EGD versus a therapeutic or an interventional endoscopy. That would be a kid, we do a scope, so we are diagnosing, we find, let's say, a bleeding ulcer. And so we've made the diagnosis, so it's diagnostic, but then also needs therapy. So through that scope that I was talking about, we can pass instruments to cauterize, to inject, to even place fancy clips to stop a vessel from bleeding, and that would be a therapeutic endoscopy. So that would be the difference between therapy and diagnosis.
Gotcha. That was very good at explaining things to the non-medical person. I'm really enjoying this. Do you do it at the same time? Like, you diagnose and you say, hey, this is what it is. Now we're treating right now while we're already in?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. Same anesthesia. They wouldn't have to wake up. The goal would be being prepared to both diagnose and do therapy at the same time.
You mentioned ulcers. What are some other common conditions that are typically identified through an endoscopy?
So there are strictures, so an area of the GI tract that's more narrow, and that would be something that we would see and visualize on endoscopy. Stomach ulcers, bleeding, inflammation that's really, really significant. We can see that. We can see those too. Polyps as well. So there's an array of things that you can see.
There always is. There's an array of things that our bodies do that are just... Luckily, we have people like you to diagnose this stuff. So what's unique about performing an endoscopy on a child versus maybe an adult?
Well, the obvious thing is the size.
You're tiny.
So you can imagine a colonoscopy on an adult. You have more room to kind of pathways open to maneuver your scope. And there's just things that are trickier in kids. Like, everything is smaller. The child's smaller. Your instruments. Oftentimes you struggle because you have to find an instrument that's big enough to allow you to pass it the instruments you need, but then also small enough to be able to fit into a small child. And then maneuvering and doing all the bending and the bowing that you need, that's hard because you have less real estate, less space to do it. But I think it's more rewarding.
Yeah. And how do parents and children, if they're old enough, typically respond when they find out they need to get an endoscopy? And
so everyone's different. Oftentimes, some people are nervous. Some kids are nervous. They get scared. Sometimes we'll start with talking with the mom or the dad about it. Sometimes they feel relieved. Finally, I need to get down to this, to the bottom of this, to the root of this. And they feel really relieved that we're doing an endoscopy, and they've been waiting and just hoping that someone can figure out what's going on. They've been suffering for months, sometimes years, with the same problem. The kids oftentimes are really nervous. They get scared. But when we let them know, hey, it's like a video game. You know, we take a look on the inside when we drive around, and your insides are going to be on this HD TV screen, and they're like, okay, and they're like, and the cool thing about it is there's no cuts at all.
No
cuts on the outside. You just wake up and it's over. And we're like, we're going to show you the pictures afterwards. Some of them were like, so cool.
I was going to ask, like, do they ever ask to play the video game after?
Some of them were like, can I see? We're like, well, we'll show you the pictures afterwards.
Yeah. That's so funny. When you mentioned that, I was like, I wonder if they ever want to watch.
Yes. No, some of them have asked, but they're asleep.
So I know there are standard endoscopies, and you mentioned earlier kind of a more advanced endoscopy. Can you tell me the difference?
Yeah. So in terms of advanced endoscopies, so that's where we say therapeutic or interventional or advanced endoscopies. Those oftentimes involve more training. And so that's what I do. I'll give you an example. One of the procedures that we do in advanced endoscopy would be an ERCP. So an ERCP stands for endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography. I know.
It's a mouthful.
Yep, it is. That's why we just say ERCP. So much easier. And so we have patients that sometimes have diseases or some type of pathology within their pancreatic or their biliary tracts. And in order to access those, a long time ago, the only way you would access that is through surgery. So it's a big surgery, open the abdomen and access those ducts. But now with endoscopy and fluoroscopy, which is live x-rays, we're able to combine those two modalities and access the bile ducts and the pancreatic ducts. We're able to dilate strictures. If there's a gallstone that's stuck in the bile duct, we're able to deliver. We're able to cut open the muscles that are draining the bile ducts and then cauterize them so there's no bleeding. And the great thing is oftentimes these kids, they wake up and their pain that they're having instantly has resolved. And they feel a lot better. They're able to eat and they're able to go home.
That's awesome. And you did the extra training. What inspired you to go and take that extra training to be a person that did the advanced?
Yeah. I like to tell the kids, like, oh, I just love, when I was little, your age, I really loved video games. I loved using my hands and dexterity. I really love those. But I love it because it's a procedure that not a lot of people do. But it makes such an impact. They can come in really, really in a bad way, yellow because of all the bilirubin that's backed up into their system, itchy because of the bilirubin, and lots of pain, vomiting, not being able to eat anything. And then after the procedure, they're 100% better. Yeah. I like the instant gratification. And in a child, it's just so much more rewarding.
Yeah.
They came in one way and then they leave smiling and giving you a hug and they're able to eat. And that is the best thing ever.
That's amazing. You mentioned you liked to play video games as a kid. What's your favorite? I have to know.
I did like Mario Kart. I did like Mario Kart. Diddy Kong Racing. I had like all the systems. Super Nintendo, yeah. The original Nintendo, N64, GameCube even. And about that time, I was starting to be pre-med. I had to kind of stop the video games. But thankfully, with endoscopy, I get to pick that out up in a different way, and it's much more rewarding.
Different video games, same kind of rewarding thing that goes on.
Challenges, yep.
So if we had everyone in Arkansas on the podcast that was trained to do advanced endoscopies on pediatric patients, how many people would that be?
Me.
Love it. So you're the only one.
I'm the only pediatric
in Arkansas doing it.
Yeah.
How's that feel?
I guess it's cool.
I think it's cool. I'm super impressed.
The wonderful thing that I'm so grateful for is that we partner with UAMS, University of Arkansas Medical Sciences Hospital, and they have adult advanced endoscopists. And there's one amazing advanced endoscopist named Samant Inamdar, Dr. Inamdar, who is my backup. So whenever I'm out of town doing medical missions or wherever, he's my backup. And he is very well trained and familiar with pediatric cases. Although he's not a pediatrician, he is wonderful. And so it's really great to know that if I'm not here, that for the urgent emergent cases, he's able to be here.
That's awesome. So you're the only person in Arkansas trained on advanced endoscopies. You're also a woman, mm-hmm. and it's March, Women's History Month. Yeah, yeah. So what inspired you? What women inspired you in your life to kind of go for this big, very cool, important thing that I think is cool, but you don't really? I don't think you know how awesome it is because you're super humble, but it's really awesome. So who inspired you in your life to be who you are today?
That's a good question. I think although she is not a doctor and although she's not an endoscopist, I would say my mom, Helen Odiase.
Hey, Helen.
She has a heart for people and where there's a need, where, the ones that people don't think about. Even growing up, I would see her always show hospitality to the least of these, the people that are often forgotten about. And her example of that is something that has inspired me so, so very much. I would also say my twin sister, Eunice.
She has a twin.
I do have a twin.
Identical?
Yeah.
Oh, nice. Okay.
And guess what?
What?
She's a pediatric. GI doctor. She's not. She is not an advanced endoscopist, but she's pediatric gastroenterologist.
You don't plan that. It just happened.
No, it happened. And I, like Eunice, my twin sister. She also has a love for children, and she's always encouraging me, and she's my biggest cheerleader. And so she's my partner in crime. We do a lot of things together. In addition to having a similar career path, she loves children, and she loves traveling the world, and doing medical missions, which we're partners together in that. And so she's always encouraging me, and she understands the need to help children around the world.
That must be pretty incredible to not only have a sister that you're close to, but one that genuinely understands your job enough that you could call and be like, oh, you would not believe the day I had.
Yes.
I mean, like, lucky, yeah. Right? That's yeah. Amazing.
It's very unique.
It is unique.
It's great because I don't have to explain.
Right. She understands all the big words yes. that you're spouting out. You don't have to.
Yes, yes. That is unique. That's a cool bond that we have. And I wouldn't trade it for anything.
Yeah. I bet the conversations around Thanksgiving are a little too deep for most to understand, right? Well, I feel like throughout this entire interview, I have been told many times over what you love about your job. Like, it pours out of you. And what you said about your mom, like, you are embodying that. Like, to a person that literally just met you, I can tell you that you are embodying all of what you said about your mom. But I always ask, so I'm going to ask you anyway, even though I feel like I know the answer, what do you love about your job?
What I love about my job is that usually by the time they see me, they've gone through a lot of pain. They've gone through a lot of frustration, and I'm able to give them a solution, and that changes things. So usually they've gone and seen a lot of different specialists, or they've gone to different hospitals and they get transferred. And I can see the relief on the parent's face whenever I say, I know what's going on. This is what we're going to do. And you can instantly see the stress in the room come down, and parents and kids are so grateful afterwards. I think there's nothing like it.
That's amazing. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. I feel like I genuinely learned a ton. We appreciated having you on, and you guys have a great day.
Thank you.